Well, thank you, and I'm so flattered by the applause which I never get when I'm in Trondheim. So, okay, I will be talking with you about a topic which is called, let me see, yes. Does it work? Yes. It's about culture in design and innovation. Yeah, and I've chosen this topic because it actually appeals to me a bit personally. And the reason why it appeals to me is that I have been subjected to culture itself, and it's a bit difficult. Well, I was born in Indonesia, and then I grew up in the Netherlands. So, and then after that, I moved to the UK, and then I moved to Singapore to work over there, and then now I'm in Norway. So, what is happening now is seeing that I will be moving away from here and there, and so on. And that's why this topic appeals to me, because I see a lot of different culture, different contradictions. So, the agenda points for what we call it, it's, can I put it up here, or it's a bit,
Why don't you use the arrows, it doesn't work?
It doesn't work? Page down? Okay. Okay, yeah, page down. Okay, what is, I use the right arrow. So the agenda for this talk is I will explain to you what is culture, culture and design, a bit about the broader context of culture and design, as well as sharing with you at the end the strategic design and how an acculturation, which is slightly different than culture, actually contribute to the development of innovative products and services. And then at the end I will sum it up. So, now, what is actually culture? What is it actually about? And I put a peel in there. It's if you say the culture, I mean, a Chinese designer has shown this, for example. Yeah. It's a bit. Yeah. It's this. Well, this is all examples of differences in cultures, yeah? And I would say, well, it's interesting to know this, yeah? But what do you do with it, you see? And now, what you see is that actually culture is a set of traditional beliefs and values that are transmitted and shared in a given society. And people are interested to it about it because people start to compare different societies. Yeah? Besides that, it also gives a total new way of thinking about patterns. It also gives a new way of thinking about how things have been transferred from generation to generation. For example, norms, values, customs, and art. Yeah? Now, showing you a bit about why culture is so interesting and why it's a topic which is something sometimes being discussed.
The English believe it's a slur on your host's food if you don't clear your plate.
I don't see it.
Whereas the Chinese feel you're questioning their generosity if you don't. At HSBC, we never underestimate the importance of local knowledge.
Okay.
HSBC,
the world's again.
The English believe it's a slur on your host's food if you don't clear your plate. Whereas the Chinese feel you're questioning their generosity if you do. At HSBC, we never underestimate the importance of local knowledge.
Forget it!
HSBC, the world's local bank.
good, we carry on. Yeah. Okay, so, well, that's what culture is about. And of course, when we talk about culture, there are a lot of problems with communication, misunderstandings in communication. What is it about? Yeah? Or something like that. Sometimes it's not a misunderstanding, but for example, if you see the one on top, you know, the squirrel. This is a typical user interface from India, because Indians never throw things away. They keep things, yeah, so that they can retrieve it. And a squirrel never throws things away. So there is never what we call it a bin, like in the Western context of interfaces. Yeah. So those are things that happen with. Okay. So besides interfaces, you also see it in products. Yeah? And you can ask yourself, well, why do the Europeans have this type of toilet pot on the left? And why do, for example, in Asian countries, do they have those one on the right? Yeah? Well, it has been proven medically that the one on the right is better, but of course, it has to do with the past, it has to do with anthropometric aspects of the person, and also what people think it's hygienic in either both cultures. Yeah? Now, besides that, looking at products which are designed in a different way from different cultural aspects, there are typical products which are have actually emerged from a typical culture itself. For example, a rice cooker. Yeah? You have a rice cooker because in Asian countries, because people eat have a lot of rice, they make it. Yeah? It's very handy. Or a Korean kimchi refrigerator, specifically for preserved Korean white cabbage vegetables. So when we look at it in the culture, within the context, within a broader context of design, we can say, well, we are moving into the context of products and services. Yeah? Culture within the context of products and services. Yeah? And why is that needed? Yeah? Yeah? Because let's say, from a product sustainability perspective, yeah, incremental innovations will not suffice anymore. This is what we all know, and that is also why there is a reason. Many case studies discuss the effects of cultural differences, yeah, on artifacts or even design of some culture-specific products. And there are not many models or processes about connecting cultures to design for radical innovation. Yeah? But actually, when we talk about culture, it's a very important aspect, especially when we talk about strategic design. For example, when we talk about what type of products and services would we like to design for the next generation. We have to consider social, political, economical perspectives, and these perspectives are usually driven by understanding of cultures and societies. Yeah? Now, take for example this, from a surface design perspective. Who do you think belongs to the most 10 most livable countries? Yeah? And you see here, for example, Norway, Sweden, the Netherlands, they are belonging to the countries with the highest quality of life. But now I show you something else. This shows Norway loses very bad on surface. So you have good quality of life, but on the other hand, you have bad surface. Yeah? What is this? Yeah? Are Norwegians not good in service to each other? Yeah? Well, you can say it's manpower, it's labor, it's expensive in Norway to hire people to serve one another, but it's also a cultural aspect. Yeah? People in the north are not used to serve one another. Yeah? For example, I just skipped this slide. Yeah? So these are elements of culture which it's nice and interesting to understand. Yeah? But what I'm coming from is not just only to understand the concept of culture, but also make the concept or the term culture operational or applicable, in other ways. How can we make culture applicable? Yeah? Now, culture itself is a very abstract thing, the word culture. It was common, it's used in the 20th century. Yeah? It comes from the German word Kultur. Yeah? And there are a lot of definitions about culture. We found around 162 definitions. But finding an operational definition of a culture is an impossible task. Yeah? But when we talk about, when we shift our mindset from culture to cultural dimensions, and not to talk about culture, but talk about cultural dimensions and use that as an aspect, as something to work further with, then the number of definitions are decreased and you have a more clearer picture of what it is about. Yeah? And what is it about, actually? It's about how you can use cultural dimensions to actually understand culture itself better, its values and beliefs connected to that, yeah? And how that then, by actually also understanding and looking at attitudes and behaviors of people, you are able then to see, okay, what type of products and services can we develop? Yeah? And of course, there are different cultural models. And for me, it's not so important what type of cultural model you use, but that you are aware of cultural models and their dimension as a tool to actually understand differences of cultures in different regions. Yeah? And for example, here, you have, just to show you a couple, Holt's model about high context and low context cultures. For example, the Dutch culture, the American culture is actually a low context culture because you have to tell people what you feel, what you think. Well, for example, the Indian culture, or maybe the Asian culture, or maybe even the Norwegian culture sometimes is in some way a high context culture because things are sometimes unspoken and expected to be understood. So this is an example of cultural models. Now, one famous guy from the Netherlands, yeah? Sorry. Hofstede has developed, for example, five cultural dimensions: power distance, individualism, etc., masculinity. And he has explained that in his book called Cultures and Organizations, The Software of the Mind, if you're interested about that. It looks at different dimensions of cultures from a business perspective. And following to that, you have the globe cultural models, which are actually looking at the similar type of dimensions, but maybe more, what we call it, more elaborately. So for example, what is power distance? Power distance, I would say, is the extent to which a community accepts and endorses authority if there is a big power between different people in organizations. You have, for example, individualism versus collectivism. You have in-group collectivism is, for example, how close are you and how much do you care and how close are you within the boundaries of your family, yeah? For example, the other one is institutional collectivism. For example, how close are you, how collective are you, for example, within society, within your work environment. And these two things are usually sometimes contradictive. Yeah? But these are some examples of dimensions. So, but as I said, cultural dimensions is a way to actually operationalize the term culture and how we can actually move towards maybe developing products and services. Yeah? Now, on top of that, I'm introducing the concept of acculturation. And acculturation is different than culture. It's complementary to culture because it actually looks at how, for example, different societies are able to accept other societies or other groups' culture. Yeah? So the concept of acculturation is actually a process of learning a culture different from the one in which a person is born and raised and takes place when an individual relocates to a new culture. And if you look it from an acculturation perspective, you can see that culture is something static. It's nice, it's good to understand, but acculturation is dynamic. And because it is dynamic, it is more useful for actually developing new products and services, and I will explain how. So, just to share with you that these are some definitions of what culture is about. And as I explained, why acculturation? Yeah, acculturation is because culture is static, and also because culture leads to comparison. And if we are thinking about comparing cultures, why don't we just form our opinion, like, okay, the culture about eating in France is much better than about eating in Norway, for example. Okay? Why don't we also form an opinion and say, do we like it? Do we accept it? Do we want to assimilate the way of French dining, for example, or not? Or do we, for example, still prefer the traditional Norwegian way of eating? So, you know the differences because you look at culture, so why don't you go a step further? Yeah? And this is what I have. And then one of these researchers has then developed a model, which is Barry. And Barry has developed a model whereby, well, if you are exposed to different cultures, you can either assimilate, yeah, that means relinquish existing culture and accept opposing culture. Yeah? For example, if you say, well, I'm from Czech and I'm going to Norway and suddenly I wear the Norwegian costume, for example, and I like Norwegian food, and suddenly say, well, this is what I am, you have assimilated. Yeah? Or you maintain your existing culture, you accept the opposing culture, you try to have both, the good things from both cultures. Yeah? So there are different ways of looking at culture and accepting it. Yeah? And here you see how it is within design. Yeah? You can actually not possible within the, but you can say like, okay, we can, for example, accept opposing culture in design is possible through design intervention, etc. So what happens a lot in the past is that there is a lot of acculturation towards the West. Yeah? And if you see on the right side, you see the workman, but then you can ask the question, why do we have a European or a Caucasian model? Why not a Japanese model? Yeah. Another example here. Can we see this?
the blonde man?
He loves me.
Right, right.
It's the boy.
Once again?
Yeah. It's okay.
Shut it.
Yeah.
Is the blonde man?
He loves me. Okay, so you see that you have acculturation. So what is, so you can ask yourself, why is that happening? Yeah. Now another thing here is you can ask yourself, this one here. Can you tell me the design consultancy, from which country the design consultancy comes from, who designed this product? Any idea? Germany? Czech? Norway?